So I'm going to talk about some work, recent work that I've done with my long-term collaborator, Benoit Pausader. So the work is on the one system that's very similar to the previous talk. It's called the Einstein-Klein-Gordon couple system. The first couple of slides, I'm just introducing the system, but it's very much in the same spirit as the one that we've seen in the previous talk. So you're looking at the Lorentzian metric in a four-dimensional open set with the induced covariant derivative and the Riemann tensor GR. And we let R alpha beta, you know, the Ricci curvature. And then we have the Einstein field system, which links the Einstein tensor of the metric with the energy momentum tensor in the space of the space time. And in this case, what makes this Einstein-Klein-Gordon is that the fact that the T alpha beta, so the energy momentum tensor, is given by just one scalar field, and the scalar field, it says this one, the alpha psi, the beta psi, plus this contribution, the scalar field is a Klein-Gordon scalar field, because of the Klein-Gordon part is this last part psi squared at the end of the tensor. And I'm going to talk about the global asymptotic stability of the trivial solution, which is the Minkowski metric M and the scalar field being equal to zero as a solution of the Einstein-Klein-Gordon couple system. So I'm going to say that, so basically what we are going to prove is that if we start with a small perturbation of this special solution, then the solution will stay global and will have a very precise description of the behavior at infinity, including ADM mass, including Bondi mass and Bondi energy. So have a very precise description of the asymptotic of the space-time at infinity. Now to understand this system as a PD, one can use the Bianchi identities, and the Bianchi identities, they produce this system in which the Ricci tensor is connected to the derivatives of psi, and psi itself satisfies Klein-Gordon equation relative to the metric G. And the way I'm thinking about this system, is a quasi-linear coupled system of equations. It turns out that this fits very well into the setting of dispersive, quasi-linear dispersive systems. It has if we just look at it for a minute, we realize that this is a multiple characteristic system in the sense that the waves corresponding to the metric, which is in this tensor alpha beta, and there are various speeds of propagation. The waves, the Klein-Gordon waves, they don't propagate at the same speed as the waves corresponding to the metric. So one has to think of this as a multiple characteristic. In this case, it turns out it's a two-speed coupled system. And it fits, it turns out, as we demonstrate through this in our work, is that it fits very well into a general theory of such dispersive systems. So now, as I said, because the metafields, they move, it's a Klein-Gordon field, the metafields moves at speed strictly smaller than the speed of light. As a result, one has various, it's a two-speed system, so one has various issues to deal with. The thing I'm going to talk about, it has three parts. And I'm going to describe them in words first, but we are going to get to, I'm going to get to exact theorems in the next couple of slides. So first we prove global regularity, meaning that in wave coordinates, we always work in wave coordinates. So we prove global regularity in wave coordinates of solutions starting with small, smooth and localized perturbations of the Minkowski solution, of the zero solution. We also prove precise asymptotics of the metric at infinity, meaning we construct nonlinear. It turns out one has to construct nonlinear scattering profiles. So the solution doesn't scatter in a linear way. It scatters in a nonlinear way. So you have to construct the nonlinear scattering profiles. And we prove that the scattering profiles after the suitable renormalizations converge in a quantitative way. And as a result, once we understand very well this profiles, we can understand very well the structure at infinity. So for example, we prove weak Peeling estimates for the Riemann tensor. We also prove ADM and Bondi energy identities and inequalities. And we can also describe the asymptotics of null and time wave geodesics. Compared to the previous lecture, compared to much of the work that has been done in this direction, because there's been a lot of work done in the direction of global stability of solutions of evolution PDs. I want to give one thing that's different in what we do is that we rely a lot on the Fourier transform. So about half of the proof is done in the Fourier space, half in the physical space. And so we have a combination, but I'm going to get into specific details, but we have a combination of energy estimates, the higher order part of the solution, we are doing, of course, energy estimates because it was a linear system. At the low order, we are using what we call a design norm, a Z norm. And that's the one that allows us to, it's not an L2-based norm, it's a separate norm. And that's what we use to prove dispersion and decay. One key advantage that I've seen in this problem, and also we've worked with more or less the same method for waterways and so in various fluids models, is that using in the Fourier space does the following thing for us. We're able to identify very clearly what's resonant and what's not resonant. All of the bilinear interactions, they basically are either resonant or not resonant. And using the Fourier analysis, we can identify very clearly what are the resonant ones. And also using the Fourier analysis, you're able to do normal forms. So the keyword here is normal forms. Doing normal forms means integration by parts in time. So we don't need to have a lot of decay. So in this problem, we actually have decay that's almost close to what we need. But for example, waterways one has a lot less decay than that. We don't need to have a lot of decay. We just need to have some. But it's more important how the decay is combined with the position of the resonances. So we need to understand all these resonances. And this leads to very precise estimates. In particular, the asymptotic results that we prove are new even for the Einstein vacuum equations, mainly because we are allowing the last large class of perturbations we start with. So we are not asking if the perturbations agree with the Schwarzschild metric at the first order. They don't have an M over R at the first order of the metric. They are non-isotropic. They are consistent to the kind of solutions of the constraint equations constructed by Carlotta and Schoen. So one should think that basically the metric I'll have actually on the next couple of slides will be an exact form, but one should think that the metric could have some mass in some direction, some other mass in some other direction. It's consistent with decay of the form 1 over R, but the metric itself does not have to be, is allowed to be non-isotropic. So the word here is non-isotropic. Okay, so I'm gonna start by describing the main theorem. So we write this as a PD problem. The Ricci tensor was, so the equation had the Ricci tensor, and we have to write the Ricci tensor in coordinates using, so these gammas, they're the usual gamma coefficients of the gamma coefficients of the metric. This Laplacian G with the tilde on top is the reduced wave operator, G alpha beta, D alpha D beta. So here we have the metric. Just think G alpha beta is close to Minkowski, so it's a little bit off. This is a small perturbation of the usual Dalong version. Gamma mu are these connection coefficients. The ones with just one index, they are the traces. So the ones that are going to turn out to be zero. They're going to turn out to be zero as we work in wave coordinates. And then we also have a semilinear term here that I put at the end, F2 alpha beta. It depends on the metric, and it has an exact formula that's written on the next page. So it has two parts. You should think that the gamma, so here I wrote the entire expressions, but later on the gammas, all the gammas, they will be equal to zero. So what's going to be left is the modified Dalong version, and also all of the semilinear terms. And there are two types of semilinear terms. The first group here, they are the ones that would have null structure, and there's a smaller group here that doesn't have the usual null structure. So I divided all the semilinear terms in this way. And this is the term, and this is the Ricci tensor. And now we can start. I'm going to state first the first tensor. We know exactly what we are talking about. So the global regularity theorem, this is the qualitative theorem saying that we can extend the solution if we start with the initial data time t is equal to zero, which is only we can extend the solution forever. So to state it precisely, we have the surface sigma naught is the surface t is equal to zero in four-dimensional space. And we assume that we have an initial data set. And the initial data set, we assume that it satisfies the usual constraint equations, which are written in these two lines, so they're the four constraint equations. And more importantly, we assume that we have smallness, and the smallness, I'm going to read and explain this one. So the smallness is all captured in this formula. So you assume that the metric G bar is close to the flat metric, the delta ij. Now this Hn spaces, these are Sobolev spaces, and the fact that we have an S here means that they are Sobolev with some weights. N is equal to 3 means that we put up to x cubed weights, and the rule is that the wave and the Klein-Gordon in the next line means that for the wave operator, we put x dx, this is the operator that we apply, while for the Klein-Gordon, we can also apply it, so we don't have to apply x dx, you can apply just x or x squared up to x cubed with or without the relatives. And so these are the space. The space are basically weighted spaces with up to three powers of x, and with the rule that in the wave case, the operators come as x dx, while in the Klein-Gordon case, they could be x. So you can also allow multiplication by x. Now, the power that we have here, so the metric G bar and the fundamental form K, these are measured in L2, in L2 base spaces. But one should think that this is of the size 1 over r. So g bar minus delta ij is the size 1 over r. Now, 1 over r, of course, is not in L2. And in order to put it in L2, we have to apply this operator delta to the 1 half. That would make it r to the 3 halves. And in order to actually put in L2, we have to put the extra delta. So that's the role of this operator, that the standard perturbation at the level of the metric should be 1 over r would get to be in L2 after applying this operator delta to the power 1/2. And for the fundamental form, it's like the decay already was like 1 over r squared, one should think, so it becomes now that to the minus 1/2. So this is the rule of these operators. But as you see, we are not asking. So what I meant to say is non-isotropic early on. We are not asking the metric agrees with some specific at the top order. We are not asking the metric to agree with some specific radial function. We are allowing it to decay in different directions at different rates, like at different masses. So there are some numbers. So the rules are that as we have more vector fields, the Sobolev norms become weaker. So these are just part of the norms. The operators that we are using are defined by the usual multipliers. So Nabla, absolute value of C is absolute value of Nabla is absolute value of C. And this bracket of Nabla is the bracket of C. And then the conclusion is, if we have such data, then the reduced Einstein-Klein-Gordon system, which is means that the Einstein-Klein-Gordon system written in that system of coordinates, and also in the harmonic gauge, admits a global solution in this spacetime, and it preserves the harmonic gauge. It stays in the harmonic gauge, gamma mu is equal to zero, and it will converge. And that's so for now, it's a qualitative system, and the metric will converge in a certain sense to the Minkowski metric, and psi will converge in a certain sense to zero as we go to infinity. But of course, we want to identify exactly, in order to be able to get all the asymptotic information about the space, I mean, to identify exactly the nonlinear profile. So it's going to be important to identify exactly the nonlinear profiles in order to make sense of this convergence. The conclusion is that now we can go back. So we can go back to the formulas of the Ricci tensor. And it turns out that the system that I wrote, this reduced Einstein-Klein-Gordon system, is actually equivalent to the Einstein-Klein-Gordon coupled system, which I wrote it at the bottom of the page. So the Ricci alpha beta minus, this is the Einstein-Klein-Gordon coupled system I started with. And that's so this means that we have global regularity. So we have global regularity in a neighborhood of the metric, of the Minkowski metric. Okay, so this is at the level of global regularity. And so this is at the level of the global regularity. Now, so here I explain exactly what the spaces are. So these are the spaces that came up when I stated the smallness assumption. Now, to be able to state the smallness assumption, I need a certain Sobolev norms that are of two types. They're the wave type and the Klein-Gordon type. And on the next slide, I explain them what they are. So just like I said, so for the wave type, we apply the vector fields we apply to measure the norms are x, dx. While for the Klein-Gordon type, we are allowed to apply x without putting the dx. And up to three, we apply up to three of these vector fields. So that's the norm. This is the norm in which we assume smallness. So that's the, so this is the system I'm going to talk about. So basically my plan is to talk about this term and also talk about the convergence and the asymptotic information that we get about the space-time. There are several simplified models that have been considered because it's kind of a complicated, if one looks, this turns out to be a pretty complicated system. It is a PDE, so it's clearly a PDE because this is just a quasi-linear D'Alembertian. The F that we had here was a semi-linear term that I wrote explicitly, but it's kind of complicated. It's got lots of terms in here. So one can look at slightly simpler models, and this has been studied as well. And one gets a lot of intuition by thinking of the simpler models. In particular, we see that the issue of modified scattering, we see it even at the level of this simple model that I wrote here. So in order to understand the asymptotic stability of this, even of the simple model, one needs to identify one of the two faces, the simpler of the two faces that we need. So even for wave Klein-Gordon models of this type, in which one looks at the Lambertian of U is some kind of V squared or maybe grad V squared. So it's a semi-linear nonlinearity in V. And for the wave operator, so for the Klein-Gordon operator is minus the Lambertian plus one V. And here one has to put this quasi-linear term in V, U times two derivatives of V. One can compare this with so this is the kind of system that would be related to Einstein-Klein-Gordon system. If we compare, we see that basically what we do, to pass from the Einstein-Klein-Gordon system to the simple system, we remove all the difficulties that had to do with the Einstein vacuum equations. The Einstein vacuum equations already would not have the size in it, but would have the other difficulties. If we remove all of those, then we still need to keep the issues coming from the wave Klein-Gordon system. So this is kind of like the logic of assuming that we already know how to understand the Einstein vacuum equations, then we need to also understand this wave Klein-Gordon system and then try to put things together. So that would be the logic of the of how these systems are constructed. Now, here I have a slide with references, and I apologize I'm missing some of the references. I have a slide with some of the references that are closely related to the problem. So of course, this global stability of the Minkowski spacetime is a very classical theorem. It's a very important theorem in general relativity. It corresponds to case psi is equal to zero. And the case psi is equal to zero, or also the system when the case when the system is coupled to the not to the massive field, but to the massless field, then that's a theorem of Isodoulou-Kleinermann. There were many new proofs and different ways of looking at it, Lidmer-Hronyansky. Now, Friedrich was actually before Isodoulou and Kleinermann. It was some kind of restricted, so the perturbations were restricted in a certain sense. They were on hyperboloids. And there was where Bieri, Zipser, Speck, Hinz, Vashi. Now, the Einstein-Klein-Gordon coupled system, the one that I'm talking about, I actually learned about this kind of problems. There was a conference in, I think, probably around 2014, 2015 at Stony Brook, and there were lectures by Le Floch, Ma, and Wang. At the time, I was working on other things, but it But that's how I learned about this problem. So there were lectures about Leflocq, by Philippe Leflocq and Wang about these problems. And they have papers. There are various levels here, so I'm not getting into a lot of discussion of these references. Some, like the earlier work, was in this situation, which everything is assumed on hyperbolic. So it's this restricted perturbation situation, each one works on hyperboloids. Now, the more recent paper of Leflocq-Ma deals with the full problem, the one that I'm talking about. In our case, we don't have any compact support. In fact, it's meaningless when you talk, because we use the Fourier transform method. It doesn't matter that we have, it would make no difference if we were to assume compact support. There's also work on a related system, the Einstein-Vlasov coupled system that we've seen earlier. Lindblad-Taylor and Bigorn, Feynman, Joudieu, Smolevich, and Teller. Now, these are just some of the, of course, there's a lot of other work on the stability of solutions of the Einstein vacuum or Einstein coupled system. I'm only talking about the ones that are closely related to the system I have here. Now, at the level of the model, so the wavecoin-Gordon models, of course, they are much simpler to, there are a lot more papers and they go back to, they go back many more years. The one that I wrote here, the one that's relevant for the, like, most of them are not relevant for the Einstein equation. So the one that's relevant for the Einstein equations is the one that I wrote on the previous page, was derived by Wang and Leflocq-Ma. Now, similar models have also been studied in two dimensions. But in two dimensions, there are the issues, and one has to make much more favorable assumptions on the nonlinearities. And there's again some recent work of Ma, Stingo, Ephraim Stingo, and Don Wyatt. Some of the recent work, there's probably more. It's not clear to me that in two dimensions one can connect this type of models to the Einstein equation. So that's something that I haven't seen done. But the level of the models, of course, one can now, so I'm going to talk, basically what I want to talk in the next few slides is I want to talk about the asymptotic stability, meaning that we want to understand the asymptotic stability of the space-time. I want to get all this information, including modified scattering, and I want to get the ATM, the Bondi energy functional. In order to get there, we need to define phase correction. It turns out that one doesn't have linear scattering. It's not possible. It's not true. There's no linear scattering even in simpler models. So what we need to do is to define what we call these phase corrections, which are defined basically at time t. So the phase correction is they all define the Fourier space. So here we track all of this modified scattering in the Fourier space. The phase corrections are defined the following way: at time t, we integrate at time t and frequency c. So we think every frequency c is correct in its own way, with a phase that depends on C and T. And what we do at time C, at time T and frequency C, we integrate certain parts of the matrix. It turns out you only need to integrate the low frequency components of the matrix are the only ones that contribute to phase correction. And we integrate them along the characteristic along the frequency C. So here we integrate H, like for example, this component A0 low, so the low frequency of A00, and the place we integrate is at time s, and then this is s c. So this is along the characteristic in the direction of c, with the correct factors. So with certain factors here, and here they actually all the other components. So integrate basically all of these components with certain suitable factors, and this is how I get the function that depends on c and t. So you see at time t, it needs to see the entire evolution. There is no, you can't predict it. So it needs to see the metric at all the intermediate times in order to, so it depends on the metric at all the intermediate times. It cannot be prescribed just by knowing the initial data. And then we have a similar correction. So both the Klein-Gordon and the metric components, they need to go through these corrections. There's a similar correction for the Klein-Gordon phase, in which case for every fixed C, we integrate, now the characteristics are different because we integrate relative to the characteristics of the integrate the metric components along the characteristics of the Klein-Gordon flow. And as I said here, the H alpha beta law, these are low frequency components of the matrix. So these are actually very explicit functions that we define, and these are the ones that are going to come in to be able to allow us to define the scattering profiles. The first paragraph here is just what I said. The geometric two-phase corrections are obtained by integrating the low frequency components of the metric along the characteristics of the wave in the Klein-Gordon linear flows. And then once we have these phase corrections, we can define the final profiles, the nonlinear profiles. We have profiles for the metric, so we should think that G are the various components of the metric. Turns out that not all of the components of the metric converge. There's one that doesn't converge. There's only one that doesn't converge, all the others converge. So you should think that G are components of the metric. So what we do is we do it in the Fourier space. So we look at the metric component G. We apply this operator that picks up both the dt and the derivative, the horizontal, the spatial derivatives of the metric G. So this is the variable UG, and then we multiply in the Fourier space. This V here should have been U. So in the Fourier space, we'll multiply by the free flow, so e to the i t absolute velocity that would have been the free flow, but we also have to put this additional correction. So this is the nonlinear profile VG star for where G are the sum of the metric components, and we have a similar nonlinear profile for the Klein-Gordon field, which is V psi star. So we multiply by, the part here, e to the I, the square root of t plus xi squared plus one times u hat of xi. This is just the linear profile, but then we have to correct it in this way. We'll correct it with this space we just construct. And the point of this construction is that after the new nonlinear profiles, here, the ones that I wrote here, VA, V omega, these are some of the profiles corresponding to the metric. Not all, as I said, not all of the components of the metric have profiles that converge. One of them doesn't converge, but these are the ones that converge. And it turns out that all of these profiles, except for that one, converge and converge in a quantitative way relative to a certain norm that I'm going to define a little later. So basically the whole point of this is that we construct objects V infinity G and V psi G, V infinity psi, which describe the entire, which basically describe the entire flow at infinity. Asymptotic, they describe the entire flow. Thankfully, the component that doesn't converge does not enter, for example, in the AD, in the Bondi mass calculations. It just doesn't come in. So this is what I mean by scattering profiles. So now that we have the scattering profiles, we can construct all of these energy functionals. We can also prove, so you can construct the energy functionals. There are several types of energies. First, there's a simple energy, the ADM energy, which measures the total deviation of the space-time from the Minkowski solution. Now the ADM energy is calculated, as we know, so it's calculated for every time t. So once we have fixed the slice for every time t, we can calculate the ADM energy. ADM energy has this formula. One looks at the sphere with the radius that increases. So the integration, so the sphere SRT, this is a sphere that with radius in, so it's a sphere in the plane sigma t with radius that increases. And one calculates it by taking some derivatives of components of the metric. So these are some components of the metric. It turns out that for the ADM energy, there is a lot of freedom. The definition will work. This is one definition. The other definition that would provide, that will give the same thing. So in our case, we show that this energy does what is expected. It is conserved. On one hand, it's conserved, it's well defined, so the limit is well defined, and it's conserved as the time in time. And moreover, it's non-negative, and it functions as an L2 conservation law in the sense that it's positive, and it functions as an L2 conservation law. As the time goes to infinity, it can be written in terms as in terms of the scattering data that we found in that we found in the previous slide. So it can be expressed in terms of the VIP psi. This is the one that comes from Klein-Gordon, the L2 norm of that squared, and these are V var theta, the L2 norm. The var theta are some of the components of the metric, and that comes in. So again, it comes in as an L2 conservation, basically. So one can think of the ADM as some kind of L2 conservation of the metric components, and it would be true at all times, except that it would not be an identity. It would be an identity up to an epsilon squared error. One would have a formula of this type at all times, except for the error. Okay, so this is the general theory about the ADMS. Now, it's a little tricky to construct a bond energy. So the bond energy supposedly happens on the non-infinity. So we need to understand very well the non-infinity of the spacetime. It's a little bit tricky to construct it. So we'd also like to compute integral over large spheres and take limits along outgoing null cones towards null infinity. But these limits are not going to exist if we don't, if we are not more careful. So in order to be able to define, we need to account properly for the geometry of the problem, meaning that we need to understand the bending of the light cones caused by the long range effect of the nonlinearity, which is the modified scattering. And for this, we construct optical functions. So the cones that we have to look at as we go to infinity, they cannot be what would be x minus t is equal to r. So they cannot be the like the cones of the Minkowski space. We have to correct them using optical functions. One can do either optical functions, or it's a little bit easier to work with this concept of asymptotically optical functions, not exactly optical functions, because in any case, it's about the limit. So as long as we so for us, asymptotically optical function means g alpha beta d alpha u d beta u is small enough. It's like of the order of r to the minus 2. And you should think that of this as r going to infinity. And then the function u itself is, so u is x minus t. This would be as if it was the usual, the Minkowski optical function, but you have to put an additional correction. And the additional correction is also close to the correction that I defined earlier, the theta correction I defined earlier near the light cone. So this additional correction satisfies kind of a technical bound of this type that says that we are close, we are going to be close relative to the we are going to be close relative to the correction that I defined earlier. So this correction that comes into the optical function is going to be close to the correction that we defined earlier in order to be able to define the modified scatter. And so we are thinking that we are in a region where, so all of these things work in a region where t minus x is more than some kind of an opening of the light cones. Okay, so in order to be able to define the bond energy, we need to define this optical function. In principle, I mean, of course, you could also work with the exact optical function, except that what the reason why we work with this almost optical function is because they are very easy to construct. So this takes maybe the exact, the almost optical functions, they're very easy to construct. And in any case, it makes no difference as we go to, as we are just talking about the asymptotic information. As long as we have sufficient decay here, like r to the minus two, almost that's enough to, makes no difference that there would be the exact optical functions. Okay, so now once we have this almost optical functions, then we look in this, we look on this surface sigma t. So the surface corresponds to t is equal to a constant. And we define the spheres relative to this optical function. And we define the normals to the spheres relative to, so these are the unit normals, but one has to, so here we have to be a little bit more careful. We have to work with the metric G bar induced, the metric on the surface induced by the metric of the spacetime, not by the Minkowski metric. So we need to work with G bar, and then we define the Bondi energy, Bondi of R, according to the same formula, which we integrate. So in this kind of, so we make all of this, so we have this normal to the sphere relative to the metric, and then we take all of these things relative to the metric. But at the end of the day, we still integrate on, so we fix R, the order is different here, we fix R, and then we think that we take the t goes to infinity, so we integrate on spheres that go for a fixed r, they go towards non-infinity, and we integrate in a way that's connected to this metric. And then the conclusions are that this, first of all, this limit exists. So if once we do it this way, once we do it carefully with the defining the metric, defining the norms and in this way, so defining the correct surfaces. This E bond of R exists for every R. As a function itself, it's a well-defined increasing function, well-defined increasing and continuous function. Now, if we go to plus infinity, so if we go to, you see, so the pictures, we have this 45 degree angle on the null infinity. If we go with R going to plus infinity, means that we move towards the space like infinity. And as we go with R goes to plus infinity, the Bondi energy approaches the ADM energy, so it picks up more and more of the full energy of the space. As we go with R towards minus infinity, then we pick up less and less. So we pick up less and less of the null infinity. And the Bondi energy converges to something that's special for this problem, namely it converges to the L2 norm of the Klein-Gordon profile. So what we have is not zero. This could have been zero. If it was in the Einstein vacuum case, it would have been zero. In our case, it's not zero because we have this Klein-Gordon profile, and the Bondi energy as R goes to minus infinity converges to the L2 norm of the final state. Again, one cannot determine this by looking at the initial data. It's something that is the final state of the Klein-Gordon evolution, and we have to calculate the L2 norm, and that's the Bondi energy as R goes to minus infinity. If you think it's consistent with the heuristics that the main part of the Klein-Gordon field doesn't see the null infinity. It all wants to go to I plus, and that's why it's all part of any of these Bondi energy independent, no matter what R is, all of them are going to. So this will basically stay inside. So the Klein-Gordon part, because it travels a speed less than one, is always going to stay inside these cones, and these cones basically look at the null infinity. So it picks up. So all of this, one should think that this energy of the Klein-Gordon part is inside all of these cones. And in fact, we can actually write, I didn't write it here, but we can, if we want to go from the energy of the Klein-Gordon part to zero, we have to take cones that are at smaller and smaller angles, less than 45 degrees. And it turns out that we can define energy in the same way. We can go from the Klein-Gordon energy to zero by reducing the angle of the cone. So this is the picture that we have for the Bondi energy. We actually provide more information. I just wrote these two pieces, the scattering information and the Bondi energy. We in fact prove more information. We also prove weak peeling estimates, meaning that we get to understand peeling estimates in the sense that the various components of the metric tensor, they go down to zero at various powers of R, and we get to do that up to the limitation that our initial data is kind of a joint initial data, does not agree with we have the weak peeling estimates up to the third level. So I'm not gonna write more of these because I wanted to give some ideas about the proof. So the proof that we do, it's a general type of proof that we've done in other situations, is what we call the Zenor method. So it goes in the following way. The Zenor method is a bootstrap argument. Once we have, of course, so in this case, you have linear stability. Once you have linear stability, everything becomes, the issue becomes to find the bootstrap argument in the right norms to pass to the non-linear stability. And the way you do it in order to, the whole point is to be able to do normal forms, to be able to, and in order to be able to do the Fourier analysis and normal forms, we use what they call the Zenor method, which means that we bootstrap two types of information that are different from each. They are different information. So on one hand, we bootstrap energy norms, and the energy here, I wrote it kind of generically. So all L2 norms, I think of them as energy. You can also apply vector fields, whatever you want to do at the level of L2. You can apply vector fields. So what would be, one would have vector fields. One can do the Sobolev vector fields. One can do the rotation. In this case, it would be the rotation and the and the Lorentzian rotations. This would be the vectors you apply in this case. And all of them are allowed to grow at certain rates. So what I say here is that all of these energy norms, they're allowed to grow. It turns out that rho can also depend on which energy you choose. There could be some kind of hierarchies that that we allow here. So that's one type of norm that has to do with the energy. The other type of norm is what is the Z norm. And the Z norm is a special norm. It has nothing to do with L2. It's in this case, I'm going to write it later on. It's an L infinity in the Fourier space kind of norm. And for this one, we want to prove sharp bounds without any loss in time as the time goes to infinity. And then it's a bootstrap argument. We bootstrap these two norms together in the sense that if we know at the time t is equal to zero, that the norm satisfy a good bound, and then we assume a slightly weaker bound at higher time, then we can prove we can improve the weaker bound using energy estimates. And the point is that the z norm, one should think of it as a low regularity norm. It's not at the high order of derivatives. And to improve the z norm, we use the Duhamel form. So this is the mechanism that we use, and this is the mechanism that we use here in this problem as well. We used it in other problems for plasma models, for Euler Maxwell equations, for water wave models. It turns out for a certain type of, for another more general form of the so-called SQG patch equation, which is some marginal Euler kind of evolution. And we used it for this problem. Now, to compare with the literature, of course, the Z norm, there are two ends of the Z norm method. The first end is when you have enough many factors. The two ends are very classical. So the first case when if you have enough many factors, it's one can construct a strong enough norm that depends on the energy. That's of course the classical energy method of Kleinermann and Christodoulou going to the 80s. So that would be no Z norm. So the Z norm would be zero, and one would just propagate energy estimates. So that's a very classical method. At the other end, it's the entire semi-linear theory is based on the other end. The other end is that in a semi-linear problem, for example, in a Schrodinger equation or in a Schrodinger map or wave maps or even Young-Niels, the Z norm method, the way it would work is that the energy plays no role. And everything is about finding the right norm to run a fixed point argument. So, and that's possible in semi-linear problems. The whole art of solving the semi-linear problem is to find a norm, which would be like for example for Schrodinger norms, for the Schrodinger equation would be like a Stricard's norm, then or an XSB kind of norm. There are trickier norms that have been used to resolve the problem using the Duhamel formula. So in a semi-linear problem, one could in principle bypass the energy part and simply focus on finding a good Z norm. In a quasi-linear problem like in which one has enough many vector fields, one could just use the energy method. But what we found really useful is this ability to gauge the relative strength of the norm. So if we have more vector fields, then maybe you need a weaker Z norm or the other way around. And they are very dual to each other. It's I'm actually coming from semi-linear theory, so all of this work from the 80s and the 90s that most of the semi-linear, almost any semi-linear problem, you wouldn't solve it using energy estimates. It would be much better to simply find a good norm to run the fixed point arguments, and that would be the Z norm in that case. So this is the method that we use. And in our case, so I'm going to get to how we use in our case. Before that, I want to put one more ingredient that I referred to earlier without being precise, and I wanted to be more precise, namely the decomposition of the metric. It turns out that, of course, there's one thing that you can talk about. In order to prove anything, we need to be able to see this weak null structure of the semi-linear terms, because we still need to understand that for just to understand the stability of the Einstein vacuum equations. And what we use, we need to use the decomposition of the metric for that. And it turns out that when we use the Fourier transform, it's not really, it's inconvenient to work with the L and L bar decompositions because those are not constant coefficients. What's much more convenient is to take Ries transforms, and we use basically a double Hodge decomposition of the metric. And so here we have Ries transform is like a derivative. So one could think that this is a double divergence, but then it's the level of the Ries transform instead of the derivative. So this is for F. for a bar, we have a similar. So we basically take least transforms of the metric components. And then for those, and then you also have this curl. So the epsilons, all of this. So this is a diff curl decomposition. And because it's a matrix, we have to decompose the whole matrix. It turns out to be a double Hodge decomposition. It's similar, it's very similar to the ADM, to the Arnowitz, Dessau-Meissner. These are the people in the ADM decomposition of the metric. And for us, actually very easy to take this kind of decomposition, because anyway, in the Fourier space, all of the least transforms, they become multipliers in the Fourier space, so they're very easy to analyze. We have the harmonic gauge condition. The harmonic gauge condition imposes some conditions on this, on some of these variables. And I don't want to get into a lot of details here. But after we do all of this, turns out that the metric is described originally there are 10 components, but of course, because you have this harmonic gauge condition, the metric is described by 6 dynamical variables, F, F bar, omega, and these var theta components. These are the variables that remain from the metric. And if we ignore the null terms, the Einstein-Klein-Gordon system becomes the F, the omega, and the var theta would be free wave equations, and the F bar would have a wave equation, but with the with quadratic terms that would not have the null structure, so I keep them. But the point is that it's the weak null structure. So the point is that these other terms, they depend on the previous variables, the ones that have better equations. So this way we can see, basically my point is that we can see very well the structure that we need. So this structure that we need in the equation in order to be able to prove anything, and we can see them very well using this ADM type of decomposition. This is the decomposition. It turns out, so now to go back, it turns out that all the components F omega and var theta, they all converge after we do all of the, so after we do the modified scattering, F bar does not. So all of the others converge except for if there's only one that does not converge, the F bar component. Now the most important part of the analysis has to do with the low frequency. And the low frequency, so it's actually the low frequency determines the low frequency of the metric. The low frequency of the metric is the one that's the that determines almost everything has to do with the asymptotic. You should think the local level to prove local regularity, of course, the high frequencies that that could be problematic. But to understand the global regularity and understand the asymptotic behavior is actually the low frequencies. And in this case, the low frequencies of the metric are the ones that that one has to focus on. And because in order to deal with them, we always work with operators of this type. So nabla, we have powers of nabla could be minus 1/2. But the point is that, the energy estimates that we define, they're all energy estimates of this type in which we put powers of nabla. One could in principle do this also in the physical space by putting weight. So for example, nabla to the minus 1/2 corresponds to x to the power 1/2. So one could in principle think of it that way. We do everything in the Fourier space though. It turns out that we measure all of this, we measure various energies of this type in which L are the vector fields containing the usual rotations and the Lorentz rotations. And it turns out that you also need to set up a hierarchy. There's a technical point that some energies are supposed to go faster than others, and you're able to set up a hierarchy that that picks all these energies. Now the profiles here, I'm just writing again what we wrote. So the profiles, the linear profiles are defined very easily. We just multiply the solution. So you take the solution, you take both the DT and the spatial derivatives of the solutions in order to capture the whole thing. And then we multiply them by these linear parts, by these linear propagators in the Fourier space. The way these operators apply to the linear profiles, we can think of this in the Fourier space. In the Fourier space, this becomes derivatives with respect to the Xi variable. So applying, for example, a vector field gamma in the physical space corresponds to taking a certain derivative of in Xi in a certain way of the profile. And here I'm restating what I said earlier, that for some of the components, the component psi is the Klein-Gordon component, is the Klein-Gordon field. F, omega, and var theta, these are the good components of the metric. We can prove nonlinear scattering. And here what I'm saying is that we can prove nonlinear scattering after multiplication by the correction phases, like I said earlier. The point of this type, however, is to define the Z norm. So everything at the end of the day, there's one thing that's more important. When you run a fixed point, like in semi-linear theory, there's one thing that's more important than everything else, which is to have a good definition of the Z norm. Everything is about defining a good norm to run a fixed point. If it's a small data problem, anything is about finding a good norm to run a fixed point argument. So in our case, the point of this slide is basically to define the Z norm. The Z norm is the norm that's not the energy norm. So the way we define the Z norm is that we look at the solution. It's the Z norm of any functions. There are two Z norms, because there's a wave norm. The wave components are measured in one way, and the Klein-Gordon components are measured in the other way. So we look at the Fourier transform of the function. We measure it in L infinity, and then we localize. So this pk referred to frequency localization. So we localize to frequency of the order of 2 to the k. And then we multiply with certain factors that, on one hand, so there are factors that are important at low frequencies. Very important how much you multiply at low frequencies, and also they're at high frequency. One should keep in mind that these norms, they're always weaker than the energy norms at high frequencies. Because at high frequencies, you need to close the energy estimate. The problem is quasi-linear. There's no way to close the Z norm at high energy. So these are all weaker at high frequencies. They're all weaker than the energy norm, but at low frequencies, they are not. So at medium frequencies, they are not weaker than the energy norm. And it's so here, these are the definitions. In this problem, we have enough many vector fields that we work with. So the Z norms, they are pretty simple. In more complicated problems, like for example for Schrodinger maps or for waterway systems that we've done using the Z norm, they get a lot more complicated. So it wouldn't be possible to write them on like a couple of lines here. But in this problem, when we have enough many vectors, like I said, the Z norm kind of has to cooperate with the energy estimates. And if we have enough many vector fields, we can capture enough information there, and then we are left only with this part of the Z. Okay, so that's basically all I wanted to say about the proof. There's only one thing that I wanted to, this is my last slide. There's only one thing I wanted to bring up, namely that there's one enemy that you could have in any of these stability problems. There's one enemy one has to be aware of, namely that it might be possible that there are stationary solutions near the one that you want to prove to be stable. And if there's a stationary solution, like there are stationary solutions that don't decay near the one that you want to be to prove to be stable, then those are going to beat any proof you have, because they're not going to allow the perturbation to just be in the stationary solution. So the presence of stationary solutions is something that would prevent any of these arguments. And it turns out that in our case, there are solutions that are very interesting. They're so-called mini bosons. They're not stationary, but they function as if they were stationary. So they're actually very explicit. So they were found in the physical literature, but there's also this work of Bison Wasserman. They're standing wave type solutions that are of this type. They're very explicit. They're almost explicit. I mean, these functions actually A, they depend on some functions, A and delta. These functions are not exactly explicit, but they are there, and they are mini bosons, so they are small. They're not exactly stationary solutions in the sense that the psi oscillate, but this would be just as bad. So if there was a solution of this type that's small near the one that you want to prove to be stable, then you wouldn't be able to prove that that's stable. And they are mini bosons in the sense they can, so they argue, Bison and Wasserman, they argue that they are arbitrarily close to the solution M, the Minkowski solution. And thankfully for us, that happens in a weak enough topology. So the topology that we assume is stronger, the topology on the Schneider is stronger in a way that we keep them out. So able to keep them out at time t is equal to zero. It turns out they don't come in. So the good thing is that they are mini bosons. They are small, but they are small in a topology that's weaker than the topology that we're able to keep our solution, our perturbations in. So that's it turns out they don't enter the problem. They could have been a lot more problematic, but they don't enter the problem. So I'm going to, let me check. So yeah, okay, so it's so I'm gonna stop here. Thank you.
Many thanks for your talk. Do we have any questions from the audience?
Yes, please.
Helmut.
What is the precise follow-up behavior of your data at space like infinity? Is it like the Kirchhoff Kleinermann, or do you include also data like BL?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear what you said.
Jeremy, can you hear me?
I mean, I can repeat Helmut's question. Helmut is asking what is the precise decay that you have on your initial data, and how it compares to what Kleinermann, have you said, had?
Kleinermann and Bieri.
So it is comparable to Bieri. It's less, we don't assume that there is a, that the solution would agree with M over I at infinity, but it is consistent with Bieri. So Bieri had the most general result of this type for the Einstein vacuum equations, in which the decay, so let me go there. So the decay is basically R to the power, if you think in terms of decay, in terms of power of R,
yes.
This will be R to the power minus one half plus, R to the power minus one plus delta.
Yeah.
So it's this.
Yeah, I couldn't work it out from this during your lecture, I'm sorry.
So you see what it is. So if it was, if it wasn't for the deltas, never mind the delta. So R to the minus one, of course, is not in L2. You need R to the minus three halves, and nabla to the one half corresponds, because R is actually at low frequency. So nabla to the one half corresponds to R to the minus one half. So it, if it wasn't for the deltas, then this would be one over R, and then nabla to the one half, that would be R to the minus three halves, which would make it consistent with being in L2. Because we only measure it in L2, so we don't put pointwise.
Okay.
So one over R would be consistent. Because of the deltas, we are actually, it's basically, so it's, so what we are allowing is R to the minus one plus delta over two, for example. So a little bit worse than, so it's not, you don't go as much as Bieri goes, but because we also want to prove the asymptotic stability, but we are assuming slightly less decay than the standard decay corresponding to M over R.
Okay, thank you.
Many thanks. Further questions? Anyone? If there is no.
Oh, can I just ask? Zoe. Yeah, sorry. Do you think you're able to treat the Maxwell-Klein-Gordon equations using your method?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We can treat all of them.
Nice. So even there, like where you don't have necessarily have derivatives on the wave part.
I actually had a student, I think, worked on the Maxwell-Klein-Gordon. No, this is harder than the Maxwell-Klein-Gordon equations. We didn't write a paper on that, but we actually had a student, I think, who wrote a paper on the Maxwell-Klein-Gordon.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we can treat pretty much all of these. It's a very general method. I'm actually coming from a different kind of problems of this type, from waterways, where there are slightly different issues. But it's a very general, once we bring in the Fourier transform and the normal forms, we can treat almost all of
this.
It's a very general, even in some problems you don't have any vector fields. Like if you have, like for example, when you work on Euler-Maxwell, when you work on plasma models, there are many types of particles. You have ions, you have electrons, there are no joint vector fields for any of them. And it almost doesn't make any difference. The vector fields don't make any difference because you can work with a good team.
Yeah. Cool, thanks.